First, I'd like to give thanks to the Lord for the honor and the blessing to be among you tonight. And before I begin, I'd like to read a little bit of the word of the Lord from the book of the letter to the Ephesians from St. Paul, chapter 3, versicle 1. It says, God's inheritance is for all. For this reason, I, Paul, came to be the prisoner of Christ for you, the non-Jews. You may have heard of the graces God bestowed on me for your sake. By a revelation, he gave me the knowledge of his mysterious design, as I have explained in a few words. On reading them, you will have some idea of how I understand the mystery of Christ. This mystery was not made known to past generations, but only now, through revelations given to holy apostles and prophets. Now the non-Jewish people share the inheritance. In Christ Jesus, the non-Jews are incorporated and are to enjoy the promise. This is the good news of which I have become minister by a gift of God, a grace he gave me when his power worked in me. This grace was given to me, the least among all the holy ones, to announce to the pagan nations the immeasurable riches of Christ, and to make clear to all how the mysteries hidden from the beginning in God, the Creator of all things, is to be fulfilled. So, for those that don't know me and haven't heard me before, I give you a small briefing of my conversion story. I was born in Colombia in a Catholic family up in the Andes Mountains in a coffee growers town. And when I was 14 years old, I was sent to the capital of Colombia to finish my high school education. And those were the 1960s. I embraced all the movements of the 60s, what we know as New Age, and walked away from the faith. I became like a persecutor of Christianity. I despised Christians for 33 years, stopped believing Jesus was God, and didn't care any longer about the Catholic faith. Engaged myself in all kinds of practices of occult sciences, divination ways, astrologies, in so many other different areas of what we know as Catholics, New Age is the language that I could say. And when I was 20 years old, I got married in Colombia, moved to Germany, went to school at the University of Hamburg in Hamburg, and became an actor and a musical composer. My two sons were born there, and then 6 years later, I moved to Hollywood, California, where I live since 1976. I dedicated myself to the entertainment industry and worked in movies and TV, and was signed as an exclusive artist to Sony Music of New York. And for many years, I traveled the world doing concerts and producing music. And I kept on growing in this, this self-centered life based on fame, power, money, pleasures, and pagan philosophies, all kinds of human ideologies, nothing to do with God. When I was 47 years old, in year 97, I went to visit with my family in Colombia and was kidnapped by the FARC rebels, the guerrillas, and they abducted me and kept me as a prisoner in the jungle for 6 months. I was sentenced to death, and the first 15 days of those 6 months, I was kept in a cave, and it was a terrifying cave. In that cave, on the day 15, I had experience with God that lasted all night long. I experienced as if I had died, and I experienced the trial of my sins. I had experience with hell, purgatory, and the presence of Jesus that was the one that led me through all this experience that absolutely changed my life forever. That night when I had the experience, I had been sentenced to death, and I knew I had no hope of making it out alive from the kidnapping. And so after that vision, I spent 5.5 months in the jungle as a prisoner, but my heart was absolutely changed. I was only praying to God every day, not to let me die without confession. The Lord had shown me the church. He went through every one of the sacraments and every one of the commandments and showed me how I had drifted away from the faith because of the actions of the devil. I fell in that trap when I was very young and walked away first from the sacrament of confession. And that hardened my heart. And later on, I lost the whole faith. And that's how I stayed as a falling away Catholic for 33 years. I was released miraculously from the captivity. And as soon as I recovered physically, I went to confession with a Franciscan priest. And then I went back to California and came back into the Catholic faith. I felt madly in love with the church and was completely sure that I was home, because everything I begin to read in the catechism of the Catholic Church and the teachings of the church was the same that the Lord had revealed to me during that mystical experience while I was captured. And so I was certain that I was in the house of the Lord, that the Catholic Church was my home, that was my mission, to be a Catholic. And I never told anyone about my mystical experience for 2 years, not even my sons, because I thought that was a big secret between God and me. He saved me. I was to change my life and live a life of obedience to Him. And to me, that was the end of that mystical experience. It was a personal experience. But 2 years later, I went to Colombia during a Holy Week. And on Palm Sunday at noon Mass, I had experience with Jesus that will be very difficult to explain. But the experience I had with the Lord clearly explained to me who I was and what I was to do. I was 49 years old, and the Lord showed me clearly that I was to leave everything I was doing and to embrace a missionary life. And that's what I did. I walked away from my career. My wife had passed away years before my conversion. She died of cancer. And when I came back from my captivity, my two sons were already independent. They were graduated. They were grown up men. They didn't depend on me. So I was perfectly ready to do what the Lord was asking from me. And so I left everything and founded a mission called Pilgrims of Love. It's a Catholic lay mission of evangelization. And I have been traveling the world for 10 years. I have been through the 5 continents and over 70 countries. And this is what I do all the time, every day of my life. My life was radically changed since that experience, not because of what happened to me with the rebels, because that is part of it. It wasn't that. It wasn't because I lost all my money, because they stole all my money. I had to pay a ransom. It wasn't because I was sentenced to death. It was because the Lord Himself placed me in a reality, in a spiritual reality, where I was made aware of who I was, what I was about, and what God was about. And I had forgotten all of that. I had left the most important thing of my life on the side. I walked away from God, and on top of that, I was persecuting Christianity all my life. The most terrifying thing I could ever do, and I did all my life. I even made productions against the church, cinematographic productions, movies and songs. And it is amazing, the mercy of God, that a person like me, after what I have done, He will rescue me, not only from being killed by the rebels, but also from condemnation. Because if I would have gone on living the life I was living, I would have ended up in hell. Because I didn't believe that hell existed. And I denied hell all my life. I made fun of people when they mentioned the word hell. And also the word sin. I will make fun of everyone when they said that. But now, today, I am here, and I will be able to testify with my life before all of you that hell does exist, And not because I read it in a book, because when I was talked about hell with the catechism of the Catholic Church, I laughed and I made fun of it. I can testify that hell does exist because I experienced it personally, because the Lord has shown it to me. And not only shown it to me, He has shown me that I belong there. When I experienced hell, my soul was so dark that it belonged there. But today, because of His mercy, love, and compassion, I am here speaking to you. And the reason why I mission every day of my life, doing what I'm doing here tonight, is because it is amazing to see how people are sleeping and how people forget that this life is just but an instant in eternity. And this life is going to come to pass very, very soon. And this is just the beginning of an eternal journey. And most everybody is sleeping. It's so sad to find Catholics that don't even believe that hell exists. Catholics that don't even think sin is a big thing. They are living a life of sin, and sometimes you find them in the church, coming to church like nothing, taking communion, never going to confession, doing horrifying things, and forgetting these incredible responsibilities that we have. It is a fact that what has been revealed to us in the scriptures is true, and I give faith to that because I know it, I have seen it, I experienced it. And it's not that I came here to get you to believe me, because that is the last thing I expect from anyone. I was the first one not to believe anybody, and nobody was able to convince me of anything that had to do with God. So it's not, that is not my duty to expect people to believe me. It is my duty just to testify that everything that is written in the scriptures is true, because I've been through that spiritually. And then it's up to everyone, the decisions everyone takes, because this is nothing new to us. We have been told this time and time again. But very few people come back from the other side, so to say, to tell us what goes on after we die. That is not very common. I'm one of them, because I could say that I have crossed the threshold of this life into the next. And I know that this is not very easy to take, but it is a fact that life goes on. And right now we are deciding our future. You see, our destiny is in our hands. We have only two choices. We either obey God or we don't. And if we don't obey God and we are not meticulously obeying God, we are going to be in a very difficult situation at the end of this life. If we do obey God and we follow meticulously His laws, His commandments, and obey Him as He is asking us to obey Him, then we will have the most amazingly wonderful life awaiting for us. Because I have seen both sides, the side of condemnation and the side of salvation. And that is one of the reasons why I could say that I am radically changed, absolutely changed like a new person. Because before I had this experience, I was so enchanted with the world. I couldn't have enough of it. I was a treasure hunter. And I tell you, I collected a lot of treasures. I was able to make lots of money. I was able to enjoy the world in its full. I was flying back and forth in private planes and going everywhere in the world, enjoying everything. Today, I tell you, they could bring me all of the treasures of earth, and I wouldn't touch them with a stick, because I have seen the real treasure with my own eyes. And that treasure is called Jesus. That is the treasure. And it is the only reason why I live today. I live for Him, because He is the reason to live. And I am so peaceful and have so much joy in my heart. And I don't have a dime to my name, nor do I want any. I never have any problems with my survival, because before I need something, He provides it for me. And He called me for this ministry, to go around the world telling people this message, to wake up and to understand that we have to prepare, we have to grow spiritually into God, within the light of the love of God, in order to be able to face what is coming up. We were chosen by name. Before we were even born, God already knew us, and He chose us as the children of God that we are, and we are responsible for the gifts that were passed along to us. We came here not to camp out. We came here not to build our hopes and dreams on this temporary life. We came here to be part of a body, of a mystical body of God that is for the salvation of souls. And that's why we are here. We were created by God as Eucharistic reparation souls. And we are here to live for those that are not living within God. We are to live the faith for those that don't know God. We are to take communion for those that do not take communion because they don't have it. We are to go to confession for those that do not know how to repent and ask for forgiveness. And we become the food of humanity, salvation of souls. We are a very vital part of salvation. And the Lord spoke to me when He related to salvation as an economy. And it's called the economy of salvation. And He said He has a plan, a perfect plan. An exact number of souls will enter the kingdom of God. And when that number is fulfilled, the Israelites will convert, and then Jesus will come back. And that is a plan, that is a perfect plan. And we have an enemy that is called Satan. And Satan's army, the fallen angels and condemned souls, that are those human beings that do not obey God. And at the end of this life, they belong to the darkness and become demonized. And they become part of the army of the fallen angels, the army of disobedience. And they are always working against us. The Lord showed me in chapter 12 of the book of Revelations, the state of the soul on earth. And He said, scriptures tell us that Saint John was told, and it was revealed to him, that one third of the angels fell, and they were thrown down to earth. They weren't thrown down to a cave, they were thrown down to earth. The word of the Lord says in chapter 12 of the book of the Revelations, He says, woe to earth and sea. Satan has been thrown down to earth and is furious because his time is running out. And that was revealed to St. John over 2,000 years ago. If you probably think about, imagine how furious he could be today when the time is getting closer. Now, here is what we're talking about. It's not that we are to be afraid of the devil, but it is that we are to be aware of the devil. And it's not that we have anything to fear, but we have everything to guard. We have to be on guard because we have an enemy, and that enemy is envious because he knows we are able to make it where he was thrown out from, and he can forgive that. That is his biggest nightmare, that human beings that were created inferior to them, that they were originally created as angels of God, and that we, being inferior to them, we will be able to enter the kingdom they were thrown out from, and we will be like they were. That is a nightmare. And they know that we are blind, deaf, and mute to the spiritual world where they are now. Because St. Paul confirms that by telling us, our battle, our struggle is not among flesh and blood alone. It's not among us alone. It's also with the spirits that roam the earth, principalities and powers of the dark, and they are here. So while we are here, we are in a state of grace. And why is it a state of grace? Because we are blessed enough not to see the spiritual world where we are, because we are on exile. We are in the equivalence of Egypt. If you read the Old Testament, you understand that the people of God, the Hebrews, that were in Egypt, they were created, they were born in Egypt, but they were people of God. But they had Egyptian tendencies and Egyptian culture. And that's why when God took them out of there into the promised land, guided by Moses, they had to be taught to be Hebrews again, because they only had an inheritance of the faith, but they had to be reminded. And many of them died because of disobedience. But that was, like St. Paul tells us, a warning for us. Because everything that happened during the Exodus is something we have to learn. And what is the lesson there? The lesson is this. They were the people of God, but they were born in Egypt. And they had all these Egyptian tendencies and customs. And they had to be cleaned up from all of that in order to become faithful to God again. So now, who are we? We are people of God that have been created on exile, equally to the people of God that were in Egypt. And the world is Egypt. We are in Egypt. And that's why St. Paul says, the Moses that came down from heaven, meaning Jesus, he came down from heaven to take us out of here, out of the exile. And he shows us how to get out of here. Moses led the Hebrews through the desert into the promised land. And that desert we can call the desert of conversion, because many of them didn't make it because of disobedience. Same thing now, Jesus, that is the Moses that comes down from heaven, comes down to teach us how to cross the desert of our conversion through the gospel, and then shows us the way. And we have to read this carefully. He came down. That means we are down. And then he ascended. And then he told us, I have to go to prepare a place for you. And where is he preparing a place? Up there, not below here, not here. Here is where we were created, but we are on exile. So because of the state of grace we are in, we are not to see the spiritual world, because we will not be able to stay here alive if we do that. We will die instantaneously, because the spiritual world that surrounds us is the fallen spiritual world. They will never make it out of here, but we will if we obey God. But many, many souls are not prepared for the moment of dying. And that's why they are caught by surprise at the end of this life, and they don't make it out of here. They stay and remain here forever. And this is what we have to understand. The scriptures are very clear about that. The scriptures tell us that we have to make it out of here. We are pilgrims. We are in transit. This is not our home. Jesus certifies that until the last minute. He is before Pontius Pilate. And Pontius Pilate is asking him if he is a king. And he answered, yes, I am a king. But my kingdom is not of this world. And time and time again, he's speaking about another world. He's speaking about an afterlife that do not belong here. He's speaking about getting out of here. And yet, this being the exile is the beginning of a precious life if we live it according to the scriptures, according to the commandments, according to the teachings of Jesus. It's a precious life, because this is the beginning of something so great, because we will embrace the glory of God forever, and God never ends. We will be forever growing into God, ever discovering Him every day new, because not even the angels know what is going to take place at this moment, because God makes everything new all the time. But for those that are in obedience to God, they will live forever within the light of God. And this is something that I know, not because I read it, like I said before, because I have seen it. And going through this world today with the conscience that I have, with the notion that I have of this temporary life, what hurts and what aches the most is the blindness, deafness, and muteness of people. People of God that were created and given all the gifts of the Spirit, the knowledge, the opportunity to be awakening to God, and they are sleeping because they fell in love with this earthly life. And they are trading the treasures of the spiritual life for the temporary treasures that are going to rotten, and that they are going to go, they're going to vanish at the end, very soon. So I will say that if I will put my message in a capsule, I will say the message will be: prepare every day of your life as if it is your last day, and you will live a very good life. Because if you wake up today and you bless yourself, you bless everyone around you, you consecrate your day to the Lord, and you go about your little human business with God and do everything in obedience to God, you will have the most magnificent life, because you will be able to have peace, joy, and you will be able to know that you are living according to God's will. And this is not only talk, this is a reality. The only way we will make it home is if we walk with God all the time. And we know that we are weak. We know we have flaws, we have weaknesses that will get us to trip along the way. But that's why God, in His infinite mercy, has given us the sacraments. It is not an accident that Jesus gave us the sacrament of reconciliation, because He knew that we needed it. We needed it to restore our friendship with God because of the mistakes we were going to make. And we are weak human beings that are about to make mistakes. But the main thing for us to do is that we are always, every day, striving to overcome all our weaknesses, fighting against them, fighting to overcome all evil, and fighting to be at peace and in obedience with God. That makes a good Catholic, that makes a faithful Catholic. The struggle, the fight against temptations. And the moment we fall, we have to get up immediately and run for reconciliation with God. And that is our walk of life. We have to walk with God that way, knowing that we, by ourselves, we're never going to make it into sainthood or perfection. God has to come along, and God will come in the person of the Son, Jesus Christ, to redeem us from all those imperfections and from all these limitations and from all this human misery that stop us from being permanently and perfectly faithful to God. But God, knowing our imperfection, knowing our temporary state, provide us with Jesus to redeem us, to complete us, because we are incomplete. And Jesus means completeness. He comes to aid us in order to get us to achieve something that is impossible for us. That's why a few days ago we were reading the gospel. The word of the Lord was talking about the young rich man of the gospel. He was fulfilling all the commandments. And he was talking to Jesus, asking how to make it into salvation. And Jesus was telling him, yes, very well. You obey all the commandments. Now, go and sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and follow me. And he couldn't do that. He continued and walked away really sad. And then Jesus was talking to the apostles on the side after he left, and he said, it is very difficult for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. And then the apostles were really puzzled with him and said, so who could be saved? And then he says, what is impossible for man is possible for God. Meaning, we are not going to be able to do it on our own. But Jesus came along to complete that incapacity we have. But all we have to do is to bring in what we are able to bring in. It's like when children are working along with the parents, and the parents ask them to give what they are able to give, and the rest they will complete, the parents. You see, and that's the way we work together with Almighty Father. That's the way we work with God. God says, give me everything you're capable of giving me. And I know it's not going to be enough, because you're never going to make it to give enough of what you have to give. But what you're lacking, I am going to give you so that you are completed. And that is the union between us and God, and that is salvation. But we have to remember, we have to be humble, because our human nature will demand for us to do it on our own and do it all and achieve perfection and sainthood on our own. And that is not possible. That is a state of pride that is very poisoning, and it's a trap that we have because of our nature. So we have to work together with our nature, but with Christ, so that we are Christ-like in everything we do. And Christ-likeness can only be achieved through humbleness, because Christ will only come into your lower nature. This human nature will only come if you open your heart, allowing him to come with the awareness that you're not able to do it on your own. So never pretend to be in control of your life, because you will be in a lot of trouble, because no one could be in perfect control of life. You have to open up and give God a chance. You have to let God come in and let him fulfill what you're not able or capable to fulfill in his fullness. We are able to bring in what we are able to bring in. And what is it that we are able to do? We are able to bring ourselves with all these limitations and with all this vulnerability and weaknesses, and bring it to God and say, here I am, Lord, to do as you will. And this is what we have to do, and to place ourselves available to God, to place ourselves in a state of abandonment to him. And that is the beginning of true faith, because that is simplicity, that is humbleness, that is something basic, elemental, and that's where truth begins. It only begins when we become that nothing. And today, you could see so many difficult situations going on with our faith, because we have the world that is coming after the church with all the weapons to destroy it. And it's not the first time in history. It happens all the time. There are cycles where everything boils to a point where the monster, the beast, is coming to devour the church. And it's not that the whole church is innocent. We know we have human elements in the church that are poisoning. That's why Jesus left Judas Iscariot until the Last Supper. He didn't fire him before the Last Supper, and he knew he was not good. He knew he was a bad apple, and he kept him until the end. Remember, when he instituted the Eucharist in the Last Supper, he talked us something very important when he gave communion to Judas Iscariot. He gave communion to everyone, bread and wine. And when he gave communion to Judas, he put the bread in the wine and gave it in his mouth and said, go and do your thing. That's what he did. And the scripture said, Satan entered in him. And you may ask yourself, how could have Satan entered when he was receiving the Eucharist? How could be that Satan? Well, Satan entered because he took communion in mortal sin. That's why Satan entered, because he was a traitor and he was thinking on betraying Jesus. And still, he took that bread and that wine of friendship with Jesus when he was his enemy. So he ate a bread he wasn't supposed to eat. He drank a wine he wasn't supposed to drink. And he pretended to be a friend when he wasn't. So he was in mortal sin and he ate his own condemnation. He walked away to do his business. And that's what Jesus tells us when we come before the altar to eat of that bread, and we are not in friendship with God because we are in sin and we haven't repented and confessed our sins. So we come here to eat that bread, being enemies of God, and we go out there to do our thing. And what is our thing? To walk on our condemnation, because that is what is going to take place if we don't straighten up. So Today we find a lot of people in the church that do not belong to the church, that they are horrifying people. You notice all the scandals that we have. People that came into the church to do horrifying things. And some of them, you will say, poor people, they fell. It was a temptation, they couldn't hold it. I don't know how we could justify that, but there's no way we could. So what can we do? First, forgiveness. We have to forgive everyone because we cannot judge any one of those people. We cannot even judge Judas Iscariot. We couldn't possibly do that. Only God can judge him. But one thing is for sure, we know that the church is also part human. And the human part of the church is not where we are to focus. Because if the apostles would have focused only on Judas, they would have lost the faith altogether. Because they wouldn't have understood what happened and why did he give him up. So today we know that we have so many scandals in the church. And you know why we have those scandals? Because the Lord is cleaning up the house first, his house. And then you know what he's going to clean next? He's going to clean this world. That's what he's going to do. But he begins by cleaning up the house first, because he is a perfect and just God. So believe me, the times that are coming are not going to be easy. We humanity is awaiting an amazing shakeup. And I'm not speaking about messages of doom and gloom, because I am far from being an end times prophet that is coming here to tell you that a comet is crashing on top of us. That might happen, but it wouldn't be anything surprising, because anything can happen anytime. But it's not about that. The cleanup, the cleansing that we are going to face is a very deep illumination of conscience for humanity. And this is coming upon us. Before that happens, the Lord is going to clean his church, because everything that was hidden is going to come to light. Nothing is going to be in the dark any longer. All of these things that were in the closet, they're going to come out. And people will think, horrible, what's going to happen to the church? Nothing. The church is going to be cleaned up. That's what is going to happen. It's the broom that is coming to sweep. And praise the Lord for that, because he's going to take all the trash out. He's going to clean the house. And a lot of people are going to go because they don't belong in the church. As simple as that. Lots of people that are there doing nothing because they don't belong there. So it's not about having a gigantic church. It's about having a true church, a real church. And that's what God wants. He doesn't need to have millions of people in the church. He needs to have real people in the church. Because when you have a real communicant in the church, that person alone is able to save lots of souls from condemnation because of the faithfulness. And when you have one rotten apple in the church, is able to take hundreds of souls to hell because of the bad example and all the influences they bring into the church. So today we face situations that are very difficult, but they are good, because when it gets so tough, it's because the battle is saving more souls. And now God comes in and brings us into these difficult times, and we are prepared because we were born to be here today. You notice sometimes when we see the young people dealing with technology like nothing. It's like toys for them. The most sophisticated technology is like a toy for the young people of today. When we are elderly people, we have a hard time with technology because it doesn't come so natural to us. And we notice how every generation has a way of dealing with things differently, because we are all created to be where we are and to face what we are to face and to deal with what we have to deal. And God is perfect. He does all of that perfectly. And so today, no one is here and is not prepared to face what we are to face. We are all equipped. A lot of people are feeling sorry about themselves. A lot of people walk around filled with fears and anxieties and despair, disillusion, and in so many horrifying ways. And you know what they act like that? Because they are all about self. They are so self-centered that they are always hurt and confused, and they are always troubled because they don't let go of themselves. But if you become humble and little, small, all of that is going to go. No more depressions, no more loneliness and fears, no more anxieties and despair. You will not be disillusioned with anyone because you're not expecting anything from anyone. Because what you do is you give unconditionally. You don't give only to be paid back. You give because you love. And you love because you love God. And God will love through you. And when God loves through you, God will not expect anything back. And that will give you peace. Because when you love unconditionally, that love feeds your soul and your heart, your whole being. And it leaves you with a state of peace and joy that nothing else could ever leave you. So today, if we want to understand how to feed ourselves with the true light, the true love, and the true peace and joy, we have to love one another unconditionally, and then we know peace and we know joy. It's the only way. And how do we love each other unconditionally? The only way to do it is when we bring God to people, because the biggest gift we could share with one another is God in us. There is nothing bigger than that. And how do you share God with others? By being obedient to God, by cleaning up this vessel. See, the gospel, today's gospel is talking about this jar where we carry the treasure. We are that vessel. We are that jar. We are that vessel of clay, as St. Paul calls it, where we carry that treasure of the Holy Spirit. And we are to do that, to bring God to others. And the way to bring God to others is to bring that charity, that forgiveness, that hope, that light, that joy of being with God. You could never possibly trust a Catholic that is sour and miserable and filled with all kinds of fears. Because how could you be a testimony of Christ in you if you are not that Catholic that brings that enthusiasm to be alive because you have God in your heart, to be hopeful because you know it's not over when it's over, because this goes on and you are going to be an eternal human being that is going to be forever living in the glory of God, and you walk in with your head up and going up into the glory of God because you know you're faithful to the Lord. And people that walk the earth like that are like thunder and lightning for the darkness. They run away. Spirits of the dark run away because they can't stand the light that you carry. And we are supposed to be that. We are supposed to be those columns of light, of hope. We are supposed to be those carriers of the power of the Holy Spirit. And we all have that in us. We can all carry that. But we have to clean up this vessel. We have to be straight. We have to obey God. And I tell you, we belong to the most precious church. We have the most precious gifts as Catholics. We have all of the truths revealed to us. All of the weapons have been given to us, the sacraments, the power of the prayers that have been passed along to us through the liturgy, through the sacred traditions, the examples of the martyrs and the saints. Everything that we have is the most amazing treasure. If we could only cash into these treasures, we will be so rich spiritually, so strong, and we will have so much authority over darkness, over the powers of darkness, and we will be able to defend our loved ones. We will be able to be a real lantern in the midst of this dark world, and we will be useful for the Lord, and we will be apostles every day of our lives in everything we do. Remember St. Francis of Assisi, he used to tell his disciples, go, and if necessary, use the words, It's about being part of God, being of God. That's all you need to do. You walk along and then you bring God to people just by existing, just by breathing, because God will do the rest. You know, sometimes we see people in the street. We find people in many places, and sometimes they don't even say a word to us, but they give us so much with their presence that it's like a healing. It's a healing presence. Sometimes we feel and we know we are around people that are very good and people of God, and they give us peace. They give us joy. They don't have to say anything. Sometimes they just walk by and you just smile at them. They smile back at you and they fill you with love. They fill you with the light of God. And you don't know how it works, but it does work. And that is what God is among us. It's a silent beauty that lives within us, around us, and everywhere. And that is God. And we're supposed to be that too. We're supposed to be that presence of God among everybody. And then we will be hope. How many times we worry about loved ones that are not with God? And the answer always is that the more we bring that light of God into our hearts, the more opportunities we have to enlighten those that are in the dark. Because the more light we carry, the more light that is going to shine out of us. We are going to be able to bring that light to everyone. So our biggest concern is not how we can convert those that are not with God. Our biggest concern should be how could we better and more faithful and loyal to God. Because that way we will bring in more light and more Holy Spirit in our lives. God will grow bigger in us. And that will be the true help to save our relatives, to save our neighbors, to save people around in our community, to save our country, to save all the responsibilities that have been entrusted to us. So let's pray to the Lord that He gives us tonight this anointing of the Holy Spirit, where our conscience could be awakened, so that we know what to do with our lives. Who am I tonight? Who am I? Am I ready to die today and face the Lord and go into the light because I have fed my soul all my life with the love of God? Were I repented good enough for me to be ready to be with the Lord at this very moment? And those questions sometimes we don't ask them because we don't want to face the fact that we're going to die. And you know, we are all going to go, and when? Only God knows. So let's use the opportunity to realize that our existence is very fragile, is very vulnerable, and is limited. So if we prepare ourselves within that vulnerability, knowing that the strength we have is Christ, because He is the one that's going to lift us up at the end of this life. When we fall, when we go down, when this flesh goes down, the Lord is going to pick us up. The Lord is going to lift us. And this is what we have to hope for. But in order to hope for that, we have to belong to Him now and in His fullness. We could not afford to keep on being mediocres, lukewarms, people that are just pretending to be in the middle, pretending to be good and bad according to convenience. That doesn't work. That game is not working for anybody. Lots of souls have been lost because of lukewarmness. So the Lord despises the mediocre. The Lord despises the lukewarm. We have to wake up and become real and go through a radical and transcendental conversion. So let's praise the Lord for the life of each one of us. I thank the Lord for each one of you, and I praise the Lord for each one of you. Each one of us is a real, true, living stone of the temple of God. If we only knew how much we can do, just us, one of us, being simple, humble, an obedient parishioner, a real communicant that comes here to take communion faithfully to God, if we only knew how powerful that action alone is, we will be the most faithful, simple, basic parishioner that will come here to pray for those that don't pray, take communion for those that don't take communion, adore the Lord for those that do not adore, forgive for those that do not forgive, and do that every day. That will be the biggest contribution for the salvation of souls. So may the Lord bless you, protect you, and guide you always towards the light. Amen.